We're so glad that you could join us today. Today, we're going to talk about making educated decisions in an unstable marketplace, which it's very unstable right now. But of course, before we get started, let's do a little housekeeping here. Remember, MountainWest IRA does not render tax, legal, accounting, investment, or other professional advice. If you need that kind of advice, accounting, tax, legal, investment, or other similar expert assistance is required. The services of a competent professional that you trust should be sought. Remember, this is educational, and when considering potential economic outcomes, it's crucial to recognize that these projections are forward-looking and subject to known and unknown risks and uncertainties. Actual results may deviate significantly from anticipated results due to various factors, including shifts in economic conditions, market dynamics, and even geopolitical events. So, I'm Diana Hoff. I am the Director of Client Relations. And this, of course, we're so lucky today. We have John with us. John Gillane is, of course, the CEO and principal of MountainWest IRA. And he has been in the financial world for years, since like 83.
I think, right? About 42 years, something like that.
Wow.
Yes, 83.
So, yeah. When we started getting questions, a lot of people are calling right now and they just aren't quite sure what to do because everything is a little wonky, a little crazy out there right now. So of course we went straight to the expert and I asked if he could come and give you some insights into kind of what's going on and what that looks like historically, because you know, things go in cycles, they happen repeatedly. So John said that he would go ahead and join me and help try and explain some of the stuff that's going on and what may be coming down the line. So, John, can you tell us a little bit about the current state of this
marketplace
economy?
Yeah. So this is really going to be an informal discussion. I'll give you my knowledge based on my time in the market, my time in watching investments and watching politics and watching global things that happen. And I started to see some similarities in this market back in 2001. With the election of the current administration, and compared it back to the elections and the economic conditions back in 1977 through 82. And most of it has played out fairly accurately. Our inflation was driven up highly by tremendous spending by the government, and tremendous printing of money by the Treasury and the Feds, and an attitude that the way to resolve the issues was to throw money at it. And unfortunately, I lived through that once before as a young man when I was coming out of college. So I remember it pretty well, and I remember the outcomes pretty well. And I wasn't real happy with the outcomes, but you know, this too passes. I think that the American people are intelligent enough to make decisions to change the course of whatever way that the economic conditions are happening. And that's what I see now. I see a marketplace where stocks are certainly top heavy, even more top heavy than they were in the 70s and 60s. And I see a marketplace where real estate values may be inflated due to not only inflation, which inflates rents, but also to a lack of being able for people to sell and buy homes. On the sell side, people can't sell because they have a lot of low mortgage rates. And if they sell, they have to buy into high mortgage rates. So it softens the real estate market a bit. A market where due to inflation, you've got higher returns on investments in the marketplace, in the Dow Industrials, and now in the NASDAQ. We didn't have the NASDAQ back then like we do now. So I really don't don't compare the NASDAQ to anything because it's a unique animal and it's dealing in unique situations that are pertinent to not the industrial world, but the technological world that we live in now. So it's a little bit different. And without getting too complex on this, I'm just simply gonna give you my quick viewpoint of where I see the market, stock market, and where I see the real estate market. And those are the only two things I'm gonna work with. I won't be giving any investment advice today. So, you know, for those of you that like to think that I give advice, I don't. But I do see some interesting things in the stock market. And I'm going to have Diana put up a slide. Unfortunately, I can't move a cursor around the slide. So I've got a paper copy that I'm going to show that you can kind of follow along. You'll see in the middle of this slide, this is the Dow of 100 years. And I used to be able to pick and choose years out of this historical price range, but the Dow was purchased by companies and they've kind of molded into a few companies where you have to buy services to be able to do what you used to be able to do for free, like a lot of things lately. So in the middle of this graph, you'll see a hump around 1950, where the market started to increase significantly after World War II. The industrial age was amongst us. The technological age was just starting. And you can see an upward market that reached a high of about almost 10,000 points on the Dow in about 1960. From there, the market kind of, just went up and down a little bit until you see a drop in the late 60s and early 70s, kind of at a time where we were coming into a recession prior to 1976, 77, and after the dollar was removed from the gold standard in 1971. So, and then you'll see a bounce up. By the way, the gray lines are recessions. Gray lines are recessions. The big gray line. Yeah. Oh, yeah. We have a lot more recessions than people realize over the years, and we survive them all. But what happened in June of 76? I know this is going to be hard to read, but if you look in the middle of the graph, there's a point where the market goes straight down for a little bit and then kind of pops back up. And that's 76. Beginning where one administration was ending and where the Carter administration was beginning, which was January 77. So let's go back to that graph. Hopefully that gives you a little bit of an idea where we're talking about on the graph. So on that bump up above 5,000 in June of 76 into January of 77, the Carter administration comes in, they loosen up money, start spending quite a bit, and you can see the market start to drop. And the drop period is 76, the end of 76 through 1982, when we were in a recession as we came out of the spending, the earlier spending. So, and the drop in that period was 47%. So it was a pretty significant drop in modern history post-World War II without a significant recession. Yes, there was a recession, but it was not a significant recession. And at the end of it, the market was down at 25, 26, 29 in 82. And in 80, there was a small recession, very small. And that was the same time, oddly enough, I'm sure most people don't remember this, the Muriel boat lift, which was when the Cuban people left Cuba in absolute droves and arrived on American shores. Nowhere near the numbers that we have today coming across the border, but in relationship, a significant movement of illegal immigration throughout the world. And this causing the market to even drop down further. That was, I believe it was November of 1980 when the boat lift was in full swing, and the crime that it brought with it and the other things. So if you look at today's market and you see that it's fairly consistent, which is very at the very end, there was a little bit of drop down to about 30,000, then back, now we're back up about 39,000. It's very toppy. It's much more toppy than it was in the 70s. But the market went down actually in the 60s, 70s period for a matter of about 20 years, which was very, very unusual and unlike the market, and has never happened since then. So some people say that the market repeats itself. Other people say the market can't repeat itself because it's a different economy, it's a different world. I like the people that say it can never happen again, right? I remember when I was a financial planner and a stockbroker working with Morgan Stanley, and Time, Newsweek, and U.S. News and World Report all reporting that the markets hit their highs. The Dow went above 10,000. NASDAQ went above 5,000, and I can't remember quite what the S&P was at, but it was also at an all-time high. So the markets hit all-time highs, and those three magazines printed stories, Dow going to 20,000 and NASDAQ going to 10,000, S&P doubling from wherever it was, I can't remember. And within months of those articles, we were in both a recession and the markets had dropped 40%. Oh. So I don't look at the press as an educated asset in what's going to happen in the market. And I'm not sure who we look at is an educated asset, because there used to be two schools of economics, without going through the boredom and the names and all of that. These two schools were basically a supply side and a demand side. And those two schools have morphed somehow, not quite sure, into a conservative base of economics and a liberal base of economics. So our economics are no longer looked at from a type of micro and macroeconomics. They're looked at from a political viewpoint on who needs to win and stay in power or keep power, whatever. Very frustrating, because I don't know that you can trust any of the market analysis as being based in economics, in true economics. And what's happened is there's been a flavoring of whatever side wants to give their viewpoint of where the economy is going to keep their side in power. I'm trying to be very non-political about this without explaining that economics today isn't what economics was when I was coming out of college and growing up. And it's just, I guess it's my way of saying I don't believe any of it. And what I do believe and what I do know about the market is that it works on a sine wave. It works on a scientific sine wave, and that what goes up must come down for a period of time for adjustments, for inflation to come down, for growth in salaries to stabilize, for housing to stabilize. And that's the fact I look at, is that there is a scientific sine wave and there is a restructuring of the economy that has to happen when our leaders have really screwed it up. And I believe that the spending that's gone on in the last few Congresses has just been horrific in putting us in this inflation economy that the only way to get out of is there must be some kind of an adjustment. There must be a change in how things happen. But what does that mean for your investments? Well, I wouldn't want to be too top heavy in stocks, because I know that if the market does, if we do have something like a 47% drop in the market, and I'm not predicting anything, I'm just telling you what I see from the past numbers. If we have a drop like that and you're heavily invested in the stock market, that could be devastating, especially if you're above the age of 50 or 55. It could be devastating. And the other thing is,
if you're already retired.
Right, if you're already retired, absolutely. And we have had markets that 15, 20 years takes to come back. Luckily, in modern history, that's not been the case, but we just don't know what's going to happen. So am I bad mouthing the markets? Absolutely not. Love the stock market. I'm just saying, be very careful. If history does decide to repeat itself with inflation and with immigration and with what happened then is happening now, there could be some significant changes in the stock market. What about the real estate market? I know that there's people out there that we've heard from that are worried about the real estate market because it's so high. What happens if we buy and it goes down? Same thing that I've just explained in the markets goes for the real estate market. Here is the one difference. If you have stocks and those stocks go down 40 to 50%, you have to wait for those stocks to come back before you can get even your principal back, your capital back. If you're in the real estate market and it goes down and you're in rentals, it will also cause a stabilization of rents. Rents are very high right now. So if rents stabilize and stay where they're at, you have income coming in through the real estate market until the market comes back. So if you can't get all of your capital back because of the decrease in the real estate market, you can keep your income consistent throughout that period. So you have income coming in. If you're not interested in income and you're just interested in capital growth, you're a dice on the table kind of person, great, go for it. But if you're someone that says, okay, if I can't get capital back, how do I survive until I can? I look at income producing, and income producing is going to be in real estate. May rents go down? Sure they may. Have they in the past? Sure they have. But we're starting to see a slowing down. It's interesting. I just got something from, I own some property in Gem County. I just got a notice from Gem County today talking about their rates of growth in the county and what property is doing. And even in their analysis and their figuring out what taxes are going to be next year, they admit that some areas have decreased in value and some areas have increased in value. So it's very unpredictable right now. It's hard to tell what's going to happen, but the income remains the same. Is the income, as we know, if you're a real estate investor, you know that incomes have gone up double, triple, and even quadruple over the past 4 or 5 years. That's a significant increase. And even if they come down a little bit, you have a stable income if your capital is tied up. So that's my best guess in the market. I know you're saying, well, you didn't say much of anything. That's right. I didn't, because just like everybody else, who knows what's going to happen? All I know is, and all I can say is be diversified and be comfortable in markets and any market reducing 30 to 50%. Because it's at these times when markets are high, when everybody forgets and says, oh, they can't do that. And I've seen it a lot in my life. I've seen it many times. I was around for 87. I was around for 91. I was around for 96. I was around for 2008. It was brutal, and it happens. So you have to be able to withstand those downtimes, and income is a great way to do that. So, and real estate is a great way to get income to do that. Just diversify and be careful. I know that you're worried. I know that you're afraid, but also know that America's great country and America is able to change. Sometimes it's slow, but it's not the Titanic. It doesn't hit an iceberg and can't figure out how to get away from it. Yes, it may hit a rock. It may go aground at times, but it also is a very vibrant economy that even in the worst of times can figure out how to bring itself back. So be careful. Cash is not king right now. When you've got people are saying, oh, with cash is king because you can get such a high interest rate, like 4 or 5% in cash. With the 9% interest or 9% inflation rate, the 20% overall inflation rate of food, energy, and housing, 20 to 30%, you're not making money in cash. You're losing money every day, every week, every month. In the current figures of inflation that they report of being 3.3%, that inflation rate of 3.3% excludes food, energy, housing. So even if you're earning 4 or 5%, you're still losing money overall when you calculate those things in. Be cautious of cash, but also be cautious of putting too much in one place in the market. That's the best experience I've had.
So what I hear you saying is diversify.
Diversify. Diversify.
Don't put your eggs all in one basket.
Yeah.
Don't put, if you trip, you got omelet.
That's right. And if you do want to put your eggs in, or you want to put a majority of eggs somewhere, put it where you're going to get income if the markets fail. Because if the markets fail, you at least have the income. If the markets fail and all you've got is capital gains to depend on getting your capital back, it could be a while.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's no good at all.
Nope.
So
hope that helps. And when you actually see this, if there's questions, you can always write questions. I'll be happy to answer back anything.
Definitely. Send us your questions, put them in the comments, and we will absolutely get back to you on those. But thank you so much for joining us. We hope this helped shed a little light in what's going on right now. We can all hope for a soft landing, but if it doesn't happen, hopefully you are diversified. And we hope you guys have a fantastic rest of your day, rest of your week. And thank you for joining us. And John, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
So when in doubt, I call John and pick his brain because he's seen it all. But thank you so much for joining us. And you guys have a fantastic day.